awesome day of FileMaker Training. I'm Richard Carlton here at fmtraining.tv, where every day we are having a great time exploring the FileMaker world together. And I mean that very seriously. We were talking yesterday. Some of you saw yesterday's action. It was the kind of the kickoff of Leland Long's kind of JavaScript dabbling exercise. We're going to be trying to get him in here once a week, although for the next 2 weeks, he's kind of out due to scheduling issues. Not on his side, it's on our side, because we had some pre-existing shenanigans that have been scheduled. So let's talk about that real quick. You go to fmtrain.tv, you can see the really cool person here. So we have the live training schedule right here. It shows that this is coming out of a FileMaker database. It shows us the upcoming broadcast schedule. And so today is basically the progression of managing digital documents. Today's conversation is really going to be awesome for the entire spectrum of FileMaker users. Only the most seasoned FileMaker developer should not watch this. Even I think there'll be some stuff in here that Nick Hunter maybe has heard of or thought of but hasn't done before. So it's good for you to do that when we watch that when we get to the end. So the next week we're going to be talking about starting point, releasing the starting point 23 release. It's mostly what we Jacob Taylor would call a quality of life upgrade or update, which means that it largely hasn't changed other than the fact that we squished about 12 billion bugs that we did not know were in the product. And so what we're going to do is we're going to release that part of it Monday, part of it Tuesday. We're going to be discussing things. Christian will be here on Thursday. So the topics for Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday are still a little open-ended, but we're going to be going through what we've done with this and how you can apply it and things that you can do with it. So it's kind of an open-ended, to a large degree, open-ended question answer part, but we'll be focused on the new release of that, which is interesting. So then Friday, Monkey Brad's Spotlight. That's Friday, April 21. And that is PDF management, right? So I'm sure there's going to be more PDF management there. That's a hot topic. It's like digital document management, PDF management are like two of the biggest things that people ask about in the FileMaker platform. A lot of organizations are still using paper. They're like, I'm in the San Francisco Bay Area. We drive electric cars and we have hover bikes and blah, blah, blah. And we use all solar power, blah, blah, blah. Hey, I hate to break it to you. You're a microcosm in your own little environment. It's not, doesn't really reflect most of the rest of the world. Most of the rest of the world still has huge processes that are not digitally handled, digitally mastered, paper. So is oh, that's so 2000. Okay, well, no, it's still a thing, right? So it's going to take a long time for people to transition fully out of using paper. And there's still huge opportunities within the world of FileMaker for us to help us, the FileMaker developer community, to help people move through that. And that's kind of what today's conversation is about a little bit. So we had some questions that were sent to us about digital document management and that kind of thing. And some people watched our digital document management show with Kyle, and they came back with some questions. And so Margaret, what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna take the questions that these people provided to us real quick. As soon as this loads. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to have you read these questions out as we go through this, right? So that is the email that was sent to me. We want to reply to these questions. A bunch of good questions were asked about digital document management. And it also occurred to me that there really is a progression of learning. So while we talk about this progression of learning here, you'll see this. You see we talk about this all the time. The progression of learning is interesting because it applies to how you interact with FileMaker, but it informs your decision making in terms of how you handle digital document management or large databases, which is where this conversation is going. A big part of today's conversation is being driven by performance, right? Performance. There is some usability items in here, but it's about performance. So let's dive into this. Do we have any objection? Are we ready to dive in? Are we good? What I'm going to do is I'm going to pop open. We're going to do this a little bit in a keynote or a PowerPoint presentation. I'm going to double click this and fire this up real quick. Four levels of digital document management, right? And so the idea is that as you're a beginning FileMaker developer, these are all the items that you're going to run into. So first off, let's assume that as a FileMaker, Claris FileMaker developer, you have at least five people using your solution, which means that you should have a FileMaker server. If you're not that far yet, this is all relevant to you, but you probably are not going to outscale FileMaker. Here's the fundamental issue that you run into is that FileMaker back, for some of you don't know this, back in the day when it was FileMaker 2, as in FileMaker Pro 2 in 1989, 90, 91, or 90, 91, FileMaker Pro 2, each table was its own file, and each table could have a maximum size of 32 megabytes. 32 megabytes, right? Our empty copy of starting point right now is a little bigger than that, right? So the idea that things have scaled up. Now, FileMaker has done very, very well with scaling text data, text numbers, things like that. What they haven't done so great with is really aggressively handling digital document management well. They always kind of are reactionary on that, not proactive, but reactionary to that. And so that's kind of what this conversation's about. So if I move down my item here, the conversation today is about all these groups. So you're a business owner, you don't really care about how FileMaker works, all the way to a new developer, intermediate, senior developer. We're going to cover this all the way from low to high for you and understand that there are four levels, and everyone starts at level one, and you move up based upon your needs. So let's talk about that. So container fields have historically stored data internally. They were originally container fields were called picture fields because they would store an image. And this is really before the advent of PDFs. PDFs didn't exist in 90, really. I saw them start to pop out in other competing formats besides Adobe's format in 93. So this goes back that far. After FileMaker 7, I think they changed the name from picture field to container. And so the containers were essentially this idea that they were internal items or blobs or internal documents that are saved inside your FileMaker file. So keep in mind that as a default mode of operation, container fields by default, the contents are saved inside your FMP12 file. So what happens is that if you bring up a field definitions, all of you have seen this before, define fields, you go to a container field, you click the storage option right here for container. This is its default screen setting right here. It won't be set to save data externally. Now, there's benefits to doing it this way. In fact, we ship starting point this way because when you're demoing something, having everything in one single file makes life much easier to understand, much easier for people to demonstrate, play with. Once the file is parked on a FileMaker server and you're not dragging it around from Windows to Mac and Mac to Windows and to maybe to Go, iOS or something like that, then you want to set it to external. You can do this, you can change this while the file is running live on a server. You change it, and what the server will do is it takes the files and moves them externally. But someone suggested I put this in terms of a cat image. And so level one, here we go. Level one is that you have a FileMaker file, you leave it with its default behavior in running, which means that if you have a couple small container, a couple small documents, or even 50 documents or something small, it will add to the size of your FMP12 file or your .claris file, right? And so the idea is that over a period of time, I can have millions and millions of records. It's not a problem, but adding 10,000 or 5,000 images is like adding 10 million records or more data. It could have a profound impact on the performance of your file. So where you could have 50 megabytes of text data, which is a lot of text. I mean, that's a ton of text. You could have 300 gigabytes of PDFs and contracts and paperwork, real easy. I have things like that all the time that I run into. So this is the artwork that we came up with. Try to explain. This is way the containers are good. So for those of you who have cats or dogs, most people like a cat or a dog, or you eat them. And maybe if you're part of the world where you eat these, that's fine. Maybe this is your food. But that being said, the one on the right has been into the treat bag too much, right? It's like a certain CEO at a certain training company. I can't get into the trees too much, or I look like that cat. So what happens is that you want to avoid that because if you have a con all the items in the container here in this one FileMaker file, then every time you have to back up the file or move the file or do something like that, it has to it your text data might be pretty small, but the rest of the cat could be pretty huge, right? And so once again, you could have this real issue of a way too big file that's really uncomfortably painful to move and to manage, right? Mark, if we have questions along the way, feel free to toss those out at me. So So this is the level one default behavior. The containers are internal into the FileMaker file. We've all seen this. We all know about it. If you watch the channel, these are things you know about, okay? We move along to level two remote containers. A lot of my stuff at RCC operates at level two. Well, and actually level four too. But this is like my aviation database, things like that. And so what I do is I turn on the containers here. And what ends up happening, we turn on we go to storage, and I turn on external storage. So what happens is that the FileMaker files, instead of it being a giant fat cat, we have a skinny cat. This only contains, this is your FileMaker file, it only contains text data. All the PDFs and digital documents and all these things that are in the container, if they're set to store externally, they're saved over here externally, right? So this one's a really pretty beefy one here. This is wouldn't even really be good for level two, but these are some pretty big files. They're all in the folder. So to move the entire solution, you have to move your FMP12 file as well as the documents directory that sits next to it. So that's level two. It's very important. So when I pop over here, if I go over here to FileMaker, I open up, say, the Kronos database right here. So this is where I store all my certified flight instructor stuff, all my aviation related stuff. I have a menu that pops up here. This, I personally built this, it's very specific to me, but if I want to see flight manuals for the 206, I click over here, and these are thumbnails right here, pretty high performance. But if I click over here and look at this record, it shows that that file is 11 megabytes, right? So if I look at the whole thing here, this whole thing is about 60 to 100 gigabytes, about 100 gigabytes of technical documentation from the manufacturer, flight instructor information, FAA, Federal Aviation Administration, regulatory stuff. There's a lot in here. And so this is where you definitely don't want a 100 gigabyte FMP12 file. What you would prefer to have is a small file, like the Kronos file itself is a little bit of text. It's maybe 5 megabytes, 10 megabytes of small. Over here, I have 90 gigs or so of digital documents. So that's like pretty great. We like that. Pretty good. Pretty straightforward. Now, moving forward, if I click the arrow to the right, level three, remote containers with FileMaker server backs these up to separate areas. So historically, the idea here with this is that your FileMaker server can back this up, say every 15 minutes or every hour, because it's small. This is giant. It almost never changes, right? So you really don't have to back it up every 15 minutes. Now, FileMaker server does some things to improve the speed of the backup. If it sees a file hasn't changed, it won't back it up. But still, if you have, you know, 10,000 files over here, it has to actually process 10,000, you know, comparison of the 10,000 live files versus the 10,000 backed up files and see if anything has changed. And if it's changed, then it writes a new one. So the idea is that you back this up maybe once a day. You back up this every 10, 15, 20 minutes, 30 minutes. So if there's a crash, you go to the last set of data here and you go to the last backup over here. You don't want to use the crash files, right? But since this changes so infrequently, generally, depends on your business, then you set these up as different backup schedules. So what happens is that Jacob Taylor did a video on this. This is where you set this up on FileMaker server. And so you go have an additional database folder. You go through the process. We have a whole recording on this one topic. So with RCC, I believe that our corporate databases with our contracts and all that kind of stuff is set up this way. For me personally, I'm not quite big enough for that with my like aviation related databases. But somewhere at some point, 100 gigabytes, 50 gigabytes, 100 gigabytes, it's probably better to switch to this technique. So this is level three. Same as level two, except the FileMaker server is configured to have the containers in a different location and on a different backup schedule. And it's smart enough to understand what's going on. FileMaker server specifically, as you can see over here, container data, folder path, etc. So this is covered in this video right here. This is level three of your growth in containers, right? And so this is a conversation of itself. We talk about how to set up the FileMaker server. It's kind of a repeat of some of the material you just saw here, but it's a good extension. Now, the Christian from Monkey Bread Software is here. And what do we use Monkey Bread Software for? We use Monkey Bread for kind of solving problems that Claris or the community can't easily solve themselves. Either Claris doesn't want to be bothered or the community doesn't know how, right? And Christian Schmidt spends every day getting tech support requests from people. How do I make thumbnails with FileMaker and then put them in a PDF and edit the PDF and move the PDF to an FTP server and then brum, 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 brum. He does this all the time with a Monkey Bread plugin. Okay. Now, I have done level four with the Monkey Bread plugin. I've also done it with some API stuff. Either way, you can do it more than one way. It's level four is more of a concept. Level one, two, and three are very concrete. Level one, the containers are internal. The FileMaker file gets fat. Level two, the containers external, but you treat them kind of as a group. So FileMaker server with the backups can still take a little bit of time. It struggles a little more than it probably should. But it's level two is the minimum that I consider for people. Level one is what you do when you're moving when you're giving someone a file to demonstrate or to check out. So then level three is where we have the separated, but we tell FileMaker server to back them up essentially on different schedules. Watch this video for that information. Now let's talk about level four. This is your very chunky kitty that's had way too many treats. And there's some videos about cats like this, and they have to go to the doctor and they have to go into a water tank and they're on a treadmill. Cats are very unhappy about trying to lose weight. So they don't take well to it, a lot like humans. So this is the issue here. And I've run into this actually at RCC with what we do with videos. So we're coming up on video 7,000 or 8,000, Margaret. I lost track. I have produced upwards of 8,000 videos over the last 15 years. We're doing at least one a day, every day. So it's, as you can see, it kind of builds rapidly. So the idea with this is that you cannot, even if you separate level three, you have the containers externally, you can't put, I mean, say that each video is 300 megabytes or 200 megabytes. And some of those numbers would be small. They're actually much larger than that. Then you have 7,000 times 300 megabytes. You're dealing with terabytes of data. And so we ran into this with a Major League Baseball team, United States. You got professional football, baseball, basketball. Professional baseball team brings RCC in. And we ended up not doing the project for them. They basically had run the technology to the end of the road. And what it was is that they had a similar sort of problem. And they had stuck in every high resolution photo from the baseball team from its official photographers since 1951 or some right? They had people there, famous Ty Cobb, famous people who had played baseball before. And, you know, famous. And they had all these high-res original photos of these folks that they had taken. They'd scanned them from slides or negatives or however they got those photos from 1951. They owned it all. It's in a database that the container repository for it was like 2 or 3 terabytes. And this is 15 years ago when terabytes was like, you know, that was like a unicorn in the wild. Like, whoa. And it cost them, you know, a ton of money. And so they were trying to figure out how to make it go faster. At the end of the day, I think that was before really solid state drives had taken off. They needed to move to SSDs, which had helped with that a lot. That being said, the idea with this scenario is that we take the concept where we have the database over here, and we have the separate containers over here, the folder with all the separate containers, and the containers know where they go, right? They know where they go. We take the extra step and moving that to someplace like AWS. And in our case, we do this exact thing with our video production. FileMaker holds all the titles of the videos, the descriptions of the videos, and holds a thumbnail, small thumbnail of the video, which could still be externally or internally if it's small enough. But the raw data, the raw video, the source, the original, is up somewhere where they can handle it. It could be in Dropbox. It could be in Amazon. I like AWS because they're infinitely professional, and they don't try to generally bone you or change the rules on you. I've never had anyone, I've never really had anyone unhappy with AWS. Sometimes people want stuff cheaper from AWS, but I've never been held hostage by them, et cetera, right? Now that can happen with some tech companies. So AWS spends a lot of time building these data centers. Like once again, we're talking about like the idea of EC2 servers. This is not an EC2 server. This is what they call S3. S3 is their simple, what is it? Simple secure storage?
Simple storage service.
Simple storage service, there it is, right? So the idea is that it's a giant repository, like a big file server in the sky, right? And it's not really being run by FileMaker, but FileMaker has links to it. So when you're in FileMaker, you can see a thumbnail, you can see a representation, right? You can see that stuff. But then if you actually want to actually see the original, you press a button, it's going to go to AWS, it's going to bring it down. It's going to leave your FileMaker server alone. I understand the FileMaker server is not really engineered for terabytes of data. I'm sure at some point terabytes will be the normal thing, right? Remember, we came from a world where 32 megabytes was a big deal. That being said, if I had terabytes of data, like this folder down here is a bunch of video production. They were shooting, they had a 8K camera, a red camera. If some of you know what high-end video production is, a red camera on the front of a helicopter flying through the San Francisco Bay Area shooting footage, 8K footage. It was so big, it blew up my Mac. So I had to get a new Mac and downsize the video. So to downsize it to 4K, right? So crazy stuff. So this is where this conversation goes. Now, before I totally dump it over to Christian Schmidt, let's talk about a couple minor things here in terms of our demonstrations. And that is that this is a sample file that Claris has distributed previously. I'm going to grab it. Nope, that's me. I'm going to grab it and move it down here. If I go over here to like clients, I click on this. Here is a container field right here. So once again, this is the basics. This is a container field. That's a little graphic on there that tells you it's a container. We don't need that. Here's the actual field itself called logo, okay? If I go to field definitions, I go to file, manage database. I could go to the client. I can see the logo file. This is a container. This is in its default environment, its default behavior, right? So the idea is that the container, if it doesn't say anything next to it, it's being stored internally. So this is level one. This is like, I don't know anything. I don't know any better. Here it is. Now, the good part about this is that you don't have to worry about if someone copies a file from point A to point B, you don't have to worry about the containers breaking because they're all inside the file. So if I put a big image in that logo folder, it's saved inside the FMP12 file, which is great. So then from there, you put it on a FileMaker server, then you open it up and you come over here and you say storage and say, oh no, I want it stored externally. Highly recommend you set to secure storage. You hit okay. And then when you hit okay down here, it's going to say, hey, I've got to convert this and do this and move this, and it's going to process it, do it. It could take it a long time. I don't think there's much data in here. So it transferred 10 images. And so now, if I'm over here, this is my FileMaker job tracking file. If I close it, next to it is a folder. This right here, this little directory structure right here, is where all the containers are now stored in here. So the job tracking file is, this is the text data with that file in FileMaker, and this is all the container data stuffed in here. The name kits and templates is customizable and changeable. Not part of the conversation today, but you can change that. Digital document management FileMakers. We had some questions that came to me at digital document management. Margaret, you remember these questions, right? And we were talking about this the other day, and I want to get to this because it's got two kind of little sub areas here I want to talk about. First off, someone said, well, I downloaded this sample file that you had, this kind of wiki file, and it's great. It's wonderful. This is a container. These are containers over here. In fact, these containers over here will actually, the way I set them up is you put things in here. If I put an image in here, it tells you the size of what's in that container, right? But the containers are in this file right here set to be local, right? So the containers in here for the moment are locally stored containers, level one. So if you put this on a server, you're going to want to change those. That way, when it starts growing, the performance doesn't take a dive, right? It stays quick. It stays fast. It stays performant is a word that people like to use. It's still performant. So someone said, well, is there, and this is just a side note on digital document management. We talked about JavaScript and Christian's talked about JavaScript. We had this JavaScript in here that Kyle Williams built. Kyle Williams is a very talented JavaScript programmer, different than Leland Long, two different people. And he built this. So as I flip through records here, I have this really wonderful interface where I can click on this and I can come in here and highlight text and do this and do that and do whatever I want. I can highlight bits and pieces and, you know, make it, you know, different colors and things like that. It's pretty slick. So someone said, well, how can I customize this? If you want to customize something in here, right, then you have to be able to code the JavaScript, right? And someone said, well, do you have to use this JavaScript text field here? No, you can use a regular text field, right? So if I go over here, if I go to Dead Bird repository right here, some of you have seen this before. This is like the junk drawer of all the little things over the years I've collected that I didn't know what to do with. So here's some sort of file right here. It's some sort of old document from 1912 about Claris and this and that and the other thing. And so this file here serves a very similar function to this file here. They look a little different, but they basically, it's a container and text. So the container on this one is over here. If I want to open it up and look at it, I press the button. These containers are externally stored. It downloads it from the server. It pops it up in a window for me, so it makes it very easy. Now, this is a Stephen Blackwell document from 2018. Okay. So, but I actually took some of the text and put it in here. So this right here is a standard text field in FileMaker. Okay. My problem is that my styling and controls, like if I want to put an image in here and have the image wrap around, or I want to put yellow in the background or something like that, it's kind of a hack to get this stuff to go. These are the limits of my text controls right here. So like down here, of course, or over here, or where was it? This one right here. I have an image that is where it wraps around it. Well, FileMaker by default with a text field doesn't support that. So if you want a rich text editor, that's kind of like a Microsoft Word or a word processor, you have to run that through JavaScript. So someone said, well, why would I want one over the other? Because I want the rich formatting here that I can get with this that I can't get over here. The downside is if you want to customize this, you have to hire Kyle or hire a JavaScript programmer to do it or learn how to program it yourself. It's in FileMaker. The data is saved actually over here. Here's the actual text field of what's being saved. And in here, it's a mix of HTML, CSS, and JavaScript in your actual text. This text over here is study of history, right? Or history of design. If I come over here and dig around in here, that text is actually in here. You dig around here.
Okay.
Go ahead, Margaret.
Questions. S3 is when you store and access occasionally.
Doesn't have to be occasionally. It could be every minute of every day. But you could have... there are pricing tiers with S3. I don't want to delve into that. That's a totally separate conversation. But like Amazon assumes that you will use S3 actively. In fact, when you run Dropbox, I think you're running on top of an S3 layer. Like when I'm over here in Dropbox, I open up Dropbox. Dropbox is a service I pay for, but I think their back end where all this stuff is saved, that's actually coming out of S3, I believe, or at least it used to. So what they did is they built a service that made S3 nicer and prettier and easier that did synchronization stuff, and they charged for that. Okay. So that's what S3 is for. We're going to get to that in a serious demo here in just a minute or two. I wanted to make sure we left the last half of this live stream for the level 4 conversations. I don't want to dive into that just yet until we've covered the issues with levels 1 through 3.
Is there a specific advantage, search speed, effective storage communication, to have this wiki environment compared to ordinary FMP screens?
The issue with that is that this is a text. This is not a straight text field. It's a mixed mash of other stuff. So if I wanted to search for the history of design, I could copy this right here. I could come over here to this field. You don't have to display this field right here. I'm going to say find, paste, and it came back with a matching record. So you can have do searches against that. That's very doable. The other question was like, how do I set up like an extension for keywords or key terms?
There's
all you define is a field, like define a field called keywords, right? And this is where you would manually set up your key. So either you do a search on the entire text or you set up your own keywords field. And if you want a keywords field, then you have it right here. You bring it over here, you put it over here, you make the window bigger, whatever you want to do, and you reorganize this. But that is, you could put your keywords in here. You could put history and marks and unsavory, right? Whatever you want to do in here, that would be your manual creation of the keywords. If you just want to search on the contents, you could search in this over here. Once again, I would build a pretty interface for this. But once again, you're doing this because you want the container capability is great within the FileMaker platform. We did levels 1 through 3, level 4 momentarily, and Christian's going to walk us through how you do it with his, and he answers all these questions. I just want to make sure that we're clear that the person who wrote the question said, well, digital document management has always kind of sucked in FileMaker. Well, it sucks if you don't know anything about levels 1 through 4, or that there are even 4 concepts here. And then the other item is that that the text editing in FileMaker is original from 1912, when the Pony Express rode across the United States to deliver the mail from the East Coast to the West Coast and through the mountains to the snow, barefoot, naked, in the mountains, freezing his ass off 100 and whatever years ago, they were using this shit over here. That's how old this is, right? Literally, right? The guy, the Pony Express guy had a laptop and he was using a FileMaker field here. That's how old this is. Why it's not been updated? I can assure you, I am not Claris, and I am not in charge of that. I cannot tell you why they have decided not to update that. We could ask Clarice that, but once again, we're off topic. I'm simply telling you that our job as developers is to find the best, easiest, fastest way to solve the customer's problem in a professional manner that they want, that they will accept. If it looks like this one down here where I'm throwing fields everywhere and it starts to look like, they may not be the best for your customer, but I am not talking necessarily to end users here. I'm talking to professional developers who are professional developers or someone who wants to be a professional developer. So any other questions from that one gentleman's paragraph
there? Yes. I miss a more structured way of organizing information. The one I saw in another video where you had the possibility of having items, categories, and subcategories.
This file is interesting. It's pretty. It's a real ugly. It's an abomination under the hood for a non-professional developer to customize, but it is beautiful. So we have this is unlocked. You can play with this if you wanted, because Nick in here has a spot where he does documents, and if you create a new record in here, then you can put a document in here, etc. I thought it was, if you play with this, it's beautiful, but it doesn't, usability is not great, at least from my opinion. That's why when I created my aviation database, or I created this one over here, I have groups of records that are over here. I can sort. This is just a master detail portal over here. This is the record. These are the supporting documents over here, right? Everything else here is, you can have URLs, but the rest of this is just stuff that you don't need, right? This could be hidden. But the idea is that it's very simple. It's very flat. If you want a very hierarchical environment, build in FileMaker. It has nothing to do with digital documents or rich text editors. It has to do with you structuring the tables, the relationships here, the portals, right? You could tell this, Nick, this screams Nick was here, right? So this is available. Margaret's posted that file for you. Which HTML editor did we use? We covered that. Margaret, if you could find that video where we covered the wiki conversation, to answer your K, we use CK for AVO data. AVO data for this file here, we use the CK editor with an open source license on it. And then we had to tweak it and customize it. So you can get this file for free from us. Yes, because we love you. This file's for free. I did not glue the two together because a lot of times we eat our own dog food, right? In fact, that's mostly what I try to convince people to do. If you see me do something, it's because I use it. I use FileMaker personally. I use it when I'm flying. I use it when I'm instructing. I use it in the world of FileMaker. I use it everywhere, right? I even have a recipe database, drives the wife nuts, okay? So all the favorite family recipes are in the database with level 2 digital document management, right? Pretty cool. But I didn't glue these together because we tried to use this at a company and I found myself wanting to scream intermittently because I'd want to tweak it. And it was like a real, it's, you know, with high beauty and high, the problem is, I think usability, I think we would have, to have Nick do it correctly, he'd have to build it, then we'd use it, and he'd have to have feedback, and you'd probably spend $20,000 going in circles over the course of a number of months building the ultimate digital document tool. Considering we're giving it away for free, I didn't feel like dropping that kind of cash on it. So I use this one. This one's available totally free. They're both totally free.
Last question, and then we should then.
Yeah, last question. We're going to pivot to Christian Schmidt.
You have an extension where FMP can be coupled with a graph system.
There are graphs built into FileMaker. Those are other live streams that we've covered. You can search for those on YouTube if you want. charting is built into FileMaker, although I think the charting built into FileMaker is extraordinarily limited. Basically, the marketing department, guy's name was Ryan Rosenberg. He thought it was a really great idea. He built this. He said, we got to do this. Ryan Rosenberg never built the database in his life. So the problem is we got stuck with charting that no one had ever wanted to use, and but it made the VP of marketing happy. So that's how we got that. So the answer is that there's something built into FileMaker. I try to never use it. I will use through an API or like Google Charts. I will use Fusion Charts. If you want an API, a paid API, really great, Fusion Charts. But you have to have a little bit of skills to play with that, right? It's not for, once again, if we have this up here, you see this graphic right here, this if I open it, pop it up. Hey, look at that, digital document management. Progression of learning. If you're doing charting, you probably have to be over here as an intermediate developer. If you're doing Fusion charting and API charting, you're going to be doing API calls, things like that. You're going to be over here on the right side even more. Okay, so just keep that in mind. The problem is with the built-in FileMaker charts is that you get going with them, then your customer says, oh, I want that to be blue, and I want that to move over this way 5 millimeters, and I want this to go up here, and I want this to go down here. And the Claris charting doesn't do that at all. It doesn't give you that kind of like when you go into FileMaker and you want to precisely control, like Nick comes over, he precisely controls this arrow right here. If I zoom in, right, and I want this arrow is precisely controlled right there, that little point in that little line. And we're talking freaking precision, like a GPS bomb dropped off a fighter jet, and it goes right through the window of the bad guy's house, right, the terrorist house. The Claris built-in charting doesn't give you that kind of capability. It basically blows up the whole neighborhood and says, if you don't like it, use something else. It's not a precision tool. So that's kind of the issue with that one. So that's why you use a online API service. Other people do charting besides FileMaker. So let's use those open source charts or those paid services that are out there already. We don't have to have FileMaker specific. So yeah, it's out there. Things are out there available. So let's talk about level 4, which is where you have a ton of digital documents, like hundreds and hundreds of gigabytes, if not more, and you need to store them somewhere. So what I want to do is bring in Christian Schmidt. We're going to spend as much time as Christian needs. And the idea is that Christian is going to show us with the Monkey Bread plugin how he would solve this level 4 storage. So the idea is that FileMaker has a link. So this is what I told Christian before he gets going. I said, Christian, ideal in level 4 is that you have the record has a link, has a thumbnail ideally of the image of whatever's on that container. The container's not in FileMaker, so FileMaker doesn't have to deal with the fatness of that file like a movie. If I press a button in FileMaker, it should allow me to spawn and view that document or view that movie. So it's instantaneous access. It's a thumbnail that kind of shows me what it might look like and maybe some text, etc. But the actual physical original is not in the file. So we post it somewhere else. Right, Christian?
Yeah. You got this idea for me, and I thought, what could I do for you?
What can you
do? And so I made 2 examples for you, okay, coming already with our new plugins in beta testing.
Let's take a look. Do the S3 first. We'll come back to the preview. Well, you can do either one. It's whatever.
Okay.
It's fine. I would do S3.
Okay, S3 first.
Here we go.
Okay, so we have this example file. I put in my credentials.
Okay, stop. Stop at the bottom. So when you set up an account with Amazon or an API service, you're going to get certain essential information, your security codes, etc. Those of you who don't understand this. So that's the bucket name. That's like the folder name on like the folder or directory. It's not the same, but it's close enough. Yeah. And then this is your like your username and password, okay? Of how to get into your AWS account, right? So just so everyone's clear.
Yep.
Okay, cool.
And since I'm in Germany, I use here EU Central as a region. So for you, it would be US West Coast or US East Coast. So you have to look up this. When you create the bucket on Amazon website, you see which area you put it. So we can import a picture And let me just load a picture here. Yeah, of course. So the picture gets imported into a temporary container, into FileMaker. Then we upload it to Amazon to this path here. And then we load it in a web viewer as a preview here. And we want, if we want to get it back, we have an export button, which downloads the file from the Amazon S3 server. Let me show you the scripts. So we have import picture, which basically goes to our temporary container, asks FileMaker to import the picture. And then we create a new record and we start the upload. So you can basically do this upload in FileMaker without a plugin. There are certainly people who have made this. The advantages with the plugins are, for example, that you can run the upload in the background if you want. So we have this as an example. We have special functions for AWS here to assign your request. And so we can build the upload request. So we build the URL here. We set the MIME type. We set the input to be the container, and then we upload it. And when we got it uploaded, we will store the path in our record and the file name. And then the temporary container gets deleted here. So we clear the temporary container. And yes. So it's now stored on Amazon.
Yeah. So David Angel asked a question, and I asked this David, excellent question, because I asked this question to Christian Schmidt originally when he built this demo. He showed it to me. David says, so you store the image in the global field before uploading to AWS.
Yeah.
And so why is
every
that
user using this database?
Yeah.
Every user using this database has their own instance of the global field. We don't commit the field. It's never stored to the server. It's just locally in memory.
Yeah, so it's never pushed up the server, which Kyle just mentioned the same thing. So yeah, there we go. Pretty cool.
Well, the next thing is we want to use a preview. And I had this idea that we use a web viewer to just show what's in the container. And for that, we use a function to get a pre-signed URL from Amazon. So we can have an URL for the web viewer, which has our authentication in there, and there's a timeout. So the URL is valid for a few days. And we can just show it in the web viewer. And basically, this way, we have a one-time authenticated URL. And yeah. It's a nice way to not have it publicly on the internet, but still be accessible when you need it.
So someone just asked a question about FM Gallery, and that's a Nick Hunter vertical market product. Really doesn't have anything to do with this here per se. It's a FileMaker. Like if FM Gallery is like this FileMaker solution that we're looking at here, any of the ones that I was playing with, the idea is that it's really good at organizing and putting them together and doing neat things with it. But at the end of the day, it's a FileMaker solution with containers. And so you can have a FileMaker solution with containers that use all the way from level 1 to level 4. At level 4, the only container we're keeping locally in FileMaker is the preview that we save. That makes sense. The only file that we save, only container that we save at level 4 is a small thumbnail preview image, right? So Nick could adapt it if he wanted to, but it's really FM Gallery is not so much, it's just a way of organizing containers in a more beautiful way, if that makes sense. David says, how is that if you don't commit before uploading to AWS? So when you write into a global field, no commit is required, David. So it's just there, right? There's no commit. I mean, if you have a global field, and you have global, and you put global data, and then you run a commit, the data in the global is not pushed back to the FileMaker server.
Okay, so the preview allows us to get a time-limited URL to show it. Mm. And then if you want to download the file, you can use a script like this to just make another curl request to download the file to back into a container and then do whatever you want. Or you can, of course, use the plugin to directly stream it on to disk. But in this case, for this example, it goes through the global container again. So we put it in the container, we export it, and actually we should maybe also clear the container after downloading it. So because I like to keep it empty.
Yeah, smart move. David, we answer your question there. There was some typing there, but I guess he added his question. How is it that if you don't commit before upload to AWS, it's fine. That's the thing. I had to learn that. We just shot the transaction videos, and people kept asking, well, how are globals affected by a transaction in FileMaker 19.6? And they're not. They're not affected by it, right? Because when you write something to a global field or a global variable, it's there immediately. It's disseminated as far as it will be on your own computer in your own session. It's not going anywhere else. So very, very important. It's really useful. If you want something temporarily that's never saved to the server at all, put it in a global. So this is pretty awesome.
I can switch between the records, and whenever I go to a record, we have here a layout trigger to load the preview again. So every time we go to the record, it creates a new URL and it can load the preview.
Okay, that's interesting. What if you had a list view with thumbnail? You can save the thumbnails, right?
We could, of course, save the thumbnails. Yeah. But in this example, it's all about uploading, downloading, preview.
Okay, good. Well, then the other thing that we came up with after that wiki conversation was this whole idea of Claris FileMaker between Macs and Windows will sometimes give you different previews. And I said, well, Christian Schmidt, if Monkey Bread was really a great product, it would help us with this. Next thing I know, we've got this file, right?
So the idea was you drop in a file, like let's take here this Excel file, and you say generate, and the plugin will do a few things and give you a picture.
Okay.
And the cool thing here is this is a longer script I started. We try several ways to make a thumbnail. So the first thing is, of course, just let FileMaker try it, if you like that. So
that's that's great. So FileMaker can do it.
Next,
never do it, right? Yeah.
So if FileMaker does it, so there's no error and there's no question mark returned, then we have a preview.
Yep.
The next thing is, let's see, we have our container read image file function, which can read more file formats on Mac and Windows than what's built into FileMaker. So let's see if that works. And if that works, we also scale it down because we want a preview, not the original picture.
Okay, hold for a second. What it says PNG up there. It's like did you hard code it to PNG?
So we have the possibility to read a lot of image formats which FileMaker doesn't know about. Like for example, this hike images you get from iPhone.
Okay.
This,
HEIC.
These are file format from Apple. Yeah. So, and this function will read the file formats understood by either Mac or Windows, and then will output a PNG container for you. So you can use that in FileMaker.
Back up. So that command right there takes the source image and it runs it through your converter and it comes out as a PNG.
Yeah, whatever format you like.
But this is
using the system functions to read images, and they can do more formats, even raw files also. So this could be a raw file and gets a PNG.
Yeah. So because we don't know what the source is, but we know that we want it to come out as a PNG. Okay, cool.
Okay. So, and because we want thumbnails, we just load it here, scale it down if needed, clear the metadata, and make a JPEG. So. That will use graphics magic.
On Twitch, Duggan says, this is very clever. Christian is very clever. Yes, this is clever stuff here. I love this stuff. This right here by itself is enough justification for you to spend 40 or 50 bucks or 80 bucks or 100 bucks on Monkey Bread, whatever your per unit cost is. It's And it does all like 7,000 things, right? This is just two of the things it's doing.
The next thing is, let's see, it could be a PDF, it could be a video.
Oh, yeah.
So we have here, if it's not a PDF and not a video, we will just try to see if our graphics image functions will load it.
Okay.
So they can also do something like 20, 30 different formats. Mm-hmm. So if it was not yet covered above, we do it here again. So similar code.
Okay.
So next thing is, the Windows side is missing. That's to do, yeah. If it's a PDF and we are on Mac or iOS, we use the Mac PDF functions. Mm-hmm. And we could also use the Windows PDF functions here.
Hey, do you have those functions?
I need to add that.
You just haven't put that in.
Right? Yeah, it's new in this version of the plugin. That's another example here, Windows PDF. But we will have another stream about what's new in the next version.
Oh, okay.
Right. Okay, so we got some Windows PDF functions which are going here, otherwise PDF kit for Mac and iOS. So if it's a PDF, we can get a review from PDF kit. If you have a Dyna PDF license, we can also use that. So you get cross-platform PDF preview. If it's not a PDF, maybe it's something here Quick Look can do. So on Mac, we use Quick Look service as the Finder would do to get nice icons. On Windows, the same function uses the preview handlers installed on Windows. So if you install something like Microsoft Office, you may get some additional preview handlers from Microsoft. And they may do previews for different file formats on Windows. And we would use this function to ask if it can make us a preview of this file. And if we got that, we have here Quick Look for either a container or here with a file. No, otherwise. Okay. And the last thing I added here was if it's a video file, we also have additional functions. So if the video file was not covered above by here Quick Look, we can still try to open the video file and ask for the image at the position of 10 seconds and make it a JPEG. That's what I came up with recently. So we can have previews of different file formats.
All right, we do have a question. I have a couple questions, so don't close anything just yet. But Pavel on Twitch says, hey, this sample file is really amazing. I can't wait to buy Monkey Bread plugin. How do I get the sample file?
If you go on our website, so let's say you go on monkeybreadsoftware.com or .de, you click on FileMaker, and then we have the better versions here, pre-release. Mm-hmm. So there is a DMG from today, or the zip for Windows and Linux.
So it looks like the 1.3.2, he's always adding functions here, but the 1.3.2 release, is that the next one that we're gonna talk about, I guess?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
13.2.
Okay. 13.
And, we also have a blog here. So on the blog, we always put in the what's new on the plugin. And one of the things is some PDF functions for Windows are coming. So you may want to try them out.
A completely unrelated question. Christian, does the Monkey Bread plugin have any charting tools?
No.
Why? Why? Why doesn't have any charting tools?
Well, I thought about it, but on the end, everyone is going with a web viewer anyway, so
well, I will not get the activity. That would make sense with web viewer with charting tool, right? You could use it that
way. I could work on getting you a picture for some data with some options. Yeah, I could do that, but
yeah, but there's already
usually people will just go with a web viewer.
I mean, we already have, Margaret, can you do a search for Google Charts in our live stream stuff and go back and find that? We've already had this conversation. So my issues primarily have to do with interactive containers, right? So that's what people have a flat container that's set to image. So just so we're all clear on this, and Christian Schmidt is it said basically the same. I'll let him run here in a second, but the You go to the container, you click on the container, you scroll down you to, I'm not sharing my screen. I am not sharing my screen. Now am I sharing my screen? There we go. I'm in layout mode. Here's a container right here, a container right here. I can select the data option right here, scroll down, and it's set right here for images, i.e. not interactive. It should just say static and dynamic. This is image, which is static content. This is the interactive. This is the one that what Nick and other people have a real problem with. And so it's when you're trying to do some really fancy dancing with a web viewer in the system. The wiki text editor that Kyle built is pretty reliable. I would not show you things that I don't use. I like it. It's reliable. A lot of things can be reliable, but this part right here, I've had in every engineer who swears by this, then they'll come back to me sniveling that their customer's mad at them for using that feature. But it just is, because it doesn't work and they don't know how to fix it, because there's no fix for this, right? That's why using containers or web viewers as a preview function, as a preview with a lower res preview function, then once again, you press the button to bring it up. So it's previewed here, but if you want the full size one, you press the open button, it goes to the server, it goes to S3, goes to wherever, and it brings up and delivers you the full meal deal. Notice we're not in FileMaker, we're actually in a dedicated app. It works the same in Windows, right? So that's the idea. I'm trying to help all of you, keep you out of trouble. But Christian Schmidt is essential here. If I had to do anything more than this basic stuff right here, I'd be screwed. In fact, sometimes I don't have thumbnails that work well. If I go over into my system here and I say, show me most of my thumbnails are PDFs, right? But if I go over here and I have some thumbnails that aren't working, Command J, every once in a while I'll get a couple of them there. Most of these are screenshots and PDFs for me, but you could have some like this one right here. That is, they were keynote. They were PowerPoint presentations that I couldn't get to display as a thumbnail. So I had to take screenshots to try to jury rig it. So I want to go back to Christian Schmidt and have him share his screen real quick. When you did the Excel preview, that's a Microsoft product. How did it generate that thumbnail? How did it do that? How did it know to do that?
So this is using Quick Look on Mac to generate a preview. So this is for numbers. Okay. And make another one here for Word file.
What's generating something has to render that image.
So
right?
In this case, this is a Quick Look handler from coming with a Pages app.
Okay, back up. So what is Quick Look? Maybe you should go.
Well, that's the thing that you press. If you press here space in the Finder and see a preview, this is Quick Look.
Okay.
And applications like Pages or Microsoft Office bring their own Quick Look little handlers. So there are little apps run in
is
the
that
background
different
to
than
generate
Quartz?
The preview.
Is that different than the Quartz library?
Yes.
It is. Okay. So there's a Quick Look library or feature, and then there's the Quartz library. It's the thing is, when I talk about libraries, folks, is that sometimes an image or a file type won't be supported in one, it's supported in the other. Now, if you take it to Windows, you said, does this Quick Look is an Apple thing, right? So
yeah, but our function uses the preview handlers on Windows. So we can get a couple of previews on Windows too, but it depends on what preview handlers you have installed.
Preview handlers installed.
Okay. Yeah.
I'm not familiar with that. Is that a special Windows thing that they install, or I don't?
Yeah, it's like a DLL, which this...
Really? Okay.
There's a preview. And
any of you Windows folks know what he's talking about? I mean, I'm sure you do, but I don't. I mean, I understand the DLL.
So I found the website. So this is a thing for Microsoft. There's an architecture for it, of course, and there are different things which can be implemented by DLLs, installed by applications into your registry, so Windows can find the right handler for the right file type.
This is good. So then
is built into Windows.
So then it's built into Windows. So you call it with the plugin, your plugin, correct?
Yeah, I call it with a plugin.
Okay.
So I have to see, I just call this functions and Yeah. I mean, if you have a handoff for file type, it should show.
Wow. Cool. Right. Yeah, David, I understood it's a library. I just didn't, I mean, yeah, I don't know. Well, this document was updated on, no, 2 years ago now. Kyle says, I've been using JS PDF, JavaScript PDF, which works great for simple HTML documents. So, good stuff. This is a good topic, good conversation, right? So, very valuable, high value, right? Pavel, folks, you got questions for us? Anyone else on Twitch? YouTube? Margaret, how are we doing on YouTube?
Yeah, good. No other questions, so we're good to probably head towards wrapping up.
All right, well, we're past our time, but I want everyone to know we are going to cut this up, clean it up, and you will see the final version sometime next week. Next week, we're starting with the starting point releases. We're going to be going through that, spending some time on that. And maybe your thing, maybe not your thing, but if you have to start a new project, you're going to want to use the 23 release because it's got a lot of the under the hood cleanup done on it. It's really great. So we're looking forward to that. So
I'm going to interrupt to actually ask one last question because I've not seen this person talk before. It's kind of a hell of a question. I have external storage with 2.5 million very small files. How to best backup? How do I back this up the best way?
If the small files, then what I would do is 2.5. Okay, so are they already in FileMaker? I guess it's kind of an open-ended question. Can I suggest that AVO Data shoot me an email with that information? Unless one of your primary competitors, in which case just let me know that you're my main competitor and I'm trying to help you. That would be fine too. But right, so that'd be great. Shoot it, support at rcconsulting.com, and I might throw it at Christian Schmidt if he wants to like chime in on it too. But let's get that on an email. We'll pick it up next week for you. Okay, cool. All right, Christian Schmidt, good job. Everyone, buy Monkey Bread. You hear me? Buy it now. You'll feel better at night knowing that you support a guy who helps build us great features. Trust me, you sleep better knowing that you support the guy. Right. FileMaker license. Well, it's potentially expired. Look at the back of that car right there. It looks like the FileMaker license has expired. Sir, I need you to step out of the vehicle. Sir, step out of the vehicle. Sir!